Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Behind your regrets and mistakes, come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Oh, what a Savior. Oh, what a Savior. Isn't he down before him, for he is Lord of all. Sing alleluia, Christ is risen. Oh, come to the altar. Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Don't come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, oh, oh. for this day, gathered in your name, calling out to you. Your glory like a fire, awakening desire, we burn our hearts with truth. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river flowing from your heart, filling every part of our prayer. Your presence in this place, your glory on our face, we're looking to the sky. Descending like a cloud, you're standing with us now, Lord, fill our eyes. You're the reason we're here. You're the reason we're singing. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, a mighty river.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Brady Witten, and it's my privilege to welcome you to worship here at First United Methodist Church in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. On behalf of our congregation, I welcome you to this time of worship.
Thank you for spending your Sunday morning with us.
During worship, it's our hope.
It's our prayer.
That you will encounter God.
That you'll come to know Jesus.
Through a verse.
Through a song.
Through a story.
Through a prayer.
Through a person.
Through a smile.
It's time to praise.
It's time to pray.
It's time to worship. Greetings, everyone. My name is Brady Witten, and I welcome you to online worship here at First United Methodist Church in Baton Rouge, Louisiana. I want to invite you, before we begin worship, to consider sharing this opportunity to worship with others, and you can do that in a variety of ways. One is by starting a watch party on Facebook. So if you go down to the bottom of your Facebook feed, or at least this portion, and hit share, there'll be an option there that says watch party. And if you're on YouTube or on our online church platform, what you can do is there are options there to share this link with other people, and you can do that via text message, via email, on social media, however you want to. And it's just a great way that you can share worship with others and invite them to worship God with us this morning. So Timothy Keller says that we don't get to decide to worship. Everyone worships something. What we get to decide is what we worship. And so at this time, in this sacred moment, I want to invite you to consider who it is that we worship. We gather here to worship God, who is our creator, sustainer, and redeemer. We gather to worship the God who is three in one, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we gather to worship the God who invites us to new life through his Son, Jesus Christ. Will you join me in prayer? Holy God, you are light, and in you there is no darkness at all. We ask that as we worship you at this time, that you would shift our focus from what is false to what is true, from the ways of this world to the ways of your kingdom. Lord, pour your Holy Spirit out upon us and help us to worship you. And it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And now I want to invite you to join in our opening hymn, To God Be the Glory.
Acknowledge our shared life together, and today the Rose honors the birth of Wilkerson Scott, child of Thomas and Katie Rohde, grandchild of Wes and Lori Rohde, born June 30th, 2020. Let us pray. Lord, you are the great Redeemer, provider, and giver of all things. We acknowledge all of these things, and we thank you for them. We recognize that we have sinned and fallen short of your glory and ask for your forgiveness. God, we come to you today asking for your mercy and your grace. We thank you for all that you have given and provided us, but we ask that you be with the state of Louisiana and specifically our friends and family in Southwest Louisiana that are in the path of yet another major hurricane. We pray for travel mercies as residents of South Louisiana evacuate to safety, and we pray for the recovery and rebuilding process that we are oh too familiar with on the other side of a great storm. Help us to be the hands and feet of Christ in the process and to embody what it truly means to love our neighbor. For we ask these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Sound that saved a wretch.
Hey friends, thanks for joining us here today. When was the last time you were invited to someone's birthday party? Now, not just anyone's birthday party, but think about the biggest birthday party you've ever been invited to. I mean, just a blowout, okay? What's the first thing you think about when you get that invitation? What am I gonna wear? And I know. I'm absolutely right. That's what everyone thinks. What am I gonna wear to this birthday party? I mean, if I showed up in a snowsuit to a pool party, I'm not gonna have a ton of fun, am I? What we wear is so important. Today, you're gonna hear a story about a king who was throwing a party, a wedding banquet, for his son. He invited so many people, and then they all said no. Well, then he went out and he invited even more people. He didn't care who came. He just wanted to pack the house. Everyone was there. They were all dressed in their wedding robes, except for one man who didn't have one on. And the king went up to him and he said, "Why aren't you wearing your wedding robe?" And the guy said, "I don't have one." He had the guy arrested and thrown out. So this is what I want you to think about throughout your week. We have all been invited into a life with Jesus. Jesus has given us an invitation into a life with him, and I hope you've accepted that invitation. And if you have, that's only half the story. The other half is, what do you wear to the party? Paul tells us in Colossians 3 to clothe ourselves in certain things, like compassionate hearts, patience, meekness, kindness, love, to clothe ourselves in all of these things. So as you go throughout your week in school, at home, on the sports field, whatever it is, I want you to clothe yourself in the characteristics of Jesus. Let's pray. God, thank you for the invitation into a life with you. And I pray that if someone watching hasn't taken that invitation, that they accept it now and then they decide to put on the clothes of Jesus. God, I pray that we are all able to clothe ourselves in meekness and patience and kindness and a compassionate heart to better show others your great love. We love you so much, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. See you guys later. Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Today's reading is from the Gospel of Matthew. Once more, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding banquet for his son. He sent his slaves to call those who had been invited to the wedding banquet, but they would not come. Again, he sent other slaves, saying, 'Tell those who have been invited, look, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding banquet.' But they made light of it and went away, one to his farm and another to his business, while the rest seized his slaves, mistreated them, and killed them. The king was enraged. He sent his troops, destroyed those murderers, and burned their city. Then he said to his slaves, 'The wedding is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore into the main streets and invite everyone you find to the wedding banquet.' Those slaves went out into the streets and gathered all whom they found, both good and bad, so that the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guest, he noticed a man there who was not wearing a wedding robe. And he said to him, 'Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding robe?' And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, 'Bind him hand and foot and throw him into the outer darkness, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen.'" This is the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
So this is a tough parable, and I want to get us thinking about a few things before we dive in too far. And I want to kind of ask this. Is Jesus saying in this parable that a person who has said yes to God's invitation, a person who's come as far as to be a part of the party that God is throwing, that that person can still miss out on God's kingdom? And is Jesus saying that God kicks some people out of God's kingdom? What's going on with this parable? So I want to invite you to think about a time that maybe you were invited to something, but as part of that invitation, you knew you were going to have to dress the part. So maybe it was a uniform for a sports team or for a job. Maybe you were in a wedding and you had to put on a tuxedo or a bridesmaid's dress, or maybe you were attending a formal dance. Can you think of a time like that? So Tasha and I and her mom and dad took a vacation to Williamsburg, Virginia one time. And while we were on that vacation, we decided we wanted to go out to a nice restaurant to eat. And so we found a restaurant in the area that had a good reputation. And looked up the information about the restaurant, it said that gentlemen were required to wear a coat and a tie. Well, I had a tie with me, and Tasha's father had a coat, but neither of us had both of them. But we decided we'd give it a try, and we'd go to the restaurant anyway. And by the way, one of the things I really love about restaurants in the Deep South is even a fine dining restaurant, that they're a little less formal than some of the restaurants up north. But anyway, so we arrived at this restaurant, and we went in. And again, I had on a tie, and Tasha's dad had on a coat, but no tie. And we went up to the maitre d's desk, and we tried to see if we could make it in. But the maitre d' says to us, gentlemen, we have a policy that all men must wear a coat and a tie. And so they gave me a loner coat to put on, and they handed Tasha's dad a loner tie. But when Tasha's dad got that tie, he kind of, you know, wasn't real sure what he thought about it, and really tried to push back a little bit and see if they were really going to make him wear the tie. And the maitre d' made it pretty clear that if we didn't wear the coat and tie, that we weren't coming in to eat. And so Tasha's dad had a decision to make. So it's amazing how many times when Jesus, and really even the prophets before him, talk about the kingdom of God, that he compares it to a feast or a dinner or a banquet. And in this parable that we saw today, Jesus tells of a king who hosted a wedding banquet for his son. And it's really quite the party. They have couchon de lait, and they have boiled crawfish, and they have cowboy ribeyes. I mean, they've got the whole spread there. And the king sends out his servants to invite people to come to this party. But we're told that the first group of people that are invited ignore the invitation. Jesus says they make light of it. One goes to his farm and another to his business. And others seize his servants. They mistreat them and even kill them. And the king is not at all happy about this and responds accordingly. So most scholars agree that this first group of invitees represent the Jewish establishment or the Jewish religious authorities. They received Jesus's invitation to a new life with God, but they refused it. They refused it. So after this first group ignores the invitation, the king sends his servants out once again, this time telling them that they're to invite anyone and anyone to his banquet, to this party. He even tells them to invite the good and the bad. And the servants go out and they do it. They do what the king has said. They invite anyone they can find to the wedding banquet. And we're told that the wedding hall is filled with guests. So if the first group was the religious establishment or the religious authorities of Jesus's day, who is the second group? So the second group are those who are invited to life in God's kingdom that are not Jewish. They're the Gentiles. This is the story of the entire New Testament about how Jesus came first to God's people, the Jewish people, and he invited them to life in the kingdom. And some of them responded. Some of Jesus' disciples were Jewish people. But he was primarily rejected by, again, the establishment or the religious rulers of the day. But anyway, from there, that invitation goes out into the world. It goes out into the known world. And Paul is a big part of spreading this gospel. And the gospel goes out to, again, non-Jewish people, to Gentiles, to you and to me. And so this second group that's invited is really the church. It's you and me and the billions of people who have heard the invitation to life in Christ and have said yes. I mean, think about it. Think about all the people over time and over continents and different languages all over the world. The wedding hall is truly filled with guests. But then something troubling happens. So just as it is today, the custom in Jesus' time was that you needed to wear appropriate attire to a wedding. I mean, when you're invited to a wedding, you dress the part, right? But when the king returns, he finds one guest who is not wearing the proper wedding attire. And he has him thrown out. Jesus tells us he's thrown out where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. It's not a place that any of us want to be. So what's going on here? What are we to make of this? And I want to go back to the questions I asked at the very beginning. Is Jesus saying that a person could say yes to God's invitation, that they can come and be a part of the banquet, they can join in the party, but then somehow still miss out on life with God? Is Jesus saying that our God, a God that we know is a God of love and grace and mercy, that God kicks some people out of the kingdom of heaven? So there's some debate about what the wedding robe represents in this parable. Gregory the Great, who was one of the early church fathers, said that the robe is love, and that as Christians we put on love. Augustine of Hippo agrees, but he uses the word charity, which is another word for love. Others say the robe is baptism. Others say it's faith. And again, there's all kinds of explanations. And these are all good answers. But I like what John Calvin has to say about this wedding robe. Calvin says this: in order to remain permanently in the king's house, we must put off the old self and lead a new life. I want to read that again. In order to remain permanently in the king's house, we must put off the old self and lead a new life. So this idea that we have to put away the old and put on the new is one that's found throughout the New Testament. Paul writes powerfully about it in multiple places, and one of the most powerful is in the book of Ephesians in the 4th chapter. And so just hear what Paul says here. He says, "You were taught to put away your former way of life, your old self, corrupt and deluded by its desires, and to be renewed in the spirit of your minds, and to clothe yourselves with the new self, created according to the likeness of God in true righteousness and holiness." So you see that language there? To put away your former way of life, and to clothe yourselves with a new self. And so the wedding robe here, I believe, and John Calvin agrees with me, is this new life in Christ. So listen to me. You and I have been invited to life in God's kingdom. We can live life in an interactive relationship with God and according to God's good and perfect will. We can live life like that. We don't have to be out of sync with God and out of sync with God's goodness. We can live an abundant life, Jesus says, an eternal kind of life. Paul says it is the life that really is life. But this life is very different than the old life, the life before we came to Christ. It's very different from life on our own terms. Paul, again, describes the difference between this old life and new life in the book of Galatians in the 5th chapter. And I want to read just a little bit to you from there. So Paul says, "The works of the flesh are obvious." And when Paul talks about the flesh, he's talking about the old life. "The works of the flesh are obvious. Fornication, impurity, licentiousness, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions, envy, drunkenness, carousing, and things like these. I'm warning you as I warned you before that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. By contrast, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." So do you see the contrast? There's life the old way, and then there's life God's way, or life, driven by God's Spirit. And when we say yes to God's kingdom invitation, we turn towards life God's way, and we necessarily turn away from this old life, a life that's sort of driven by me and my and mine and my desires and my wants. So is Jesus saying that a person who has said yes to God's invitation, a person who has gone as far as to show up to God's party, can still miss out on life with God? I think the answer is yes. And the truth is, it happens all the time. There are people who participate in the body of Christ, people who participate in the life of the church. They go to Sunday school, they take Bible studies, they do all kinds of Christian stuff, but they never surrender their life to God's way. They just keep living their own way. There's a famous preacher named Billy Sunday who said this one time. He said, going to church doesn't make you a Christian any more than going to a garage makes you an automobile. So I've seen it all throughout my ministry. Church people who claim the name of Christ, who really show very little interest in living God's way, living a kingdom life. Now, when we hear stuff like this, we often tend to focus on kind of the external stuff that Paul lifts up. We go, that's right, there's fornicators out there and drunks out there, and if they're going to come to Christ, they need to turn away from those things. But what about the rest of Paul's list? What about things like strife, jealousy, anger, quarrels, dissensions, factions? I see those kinds of things all over the church. Don't you? If we claim the name of Christ and we're living life in that way, we need to check our clothes. If we claim the name of Christ and we spread lies and rumors about other people, even public figures on social media, if that's what we're about, we need to check our clothes. If we claim the name of Christ and we wish our opponents sick or dead, we need to check our clothes. If we claim the name of Christ and we have no care for the poor or for the oppressed or for justice, we really need to check our clothes. Do you understand? Now listen, I'm not talking about the times that we try to live up to God's will and we fall short. That happens to all of us. And I have to believe that if that wedding guest was there sincerely and maybe had just misplaced his robe or was trying to put it on, that the king would have seen that and he would have allowed that man to stay. But I think what the king saw was this man's just refusal to participate, refusal to join in the party. I'm talking about the times that we know that God has called us a different way and we just refuse. Or the times that we have so closed our hearts to God that we can't even hear God's Spirit speaking anymore. So is Jesus saying that a person who has said yes to God's invitation, a person who has gone as far as to show up to the party, can miss out on life with God? He is. And is he saying that God, our God of love and grace, kicks some people out of the kingdom of God? So Tasha's mom and her dad and I were all standing at that maitre d's sort of counter, and I had put on my coat, and Tasha's dad had that tie in his hand, and he was kind of trying to decide what he was going to do. And again, he was struggling with this a little bit. And I understand, like, I have that side of my personality too. Do we all? You know, that hey, you're not going to tell me what to do side. Or maybe what was going on in his head was just trying to figure out, you know, how important is this to me? Do I really want to go in to eat? I mean, is it that important to me that I'm going to put on this tie even though I don't want to do it? Whatever his reason, think about this. If he had decided not to put on the tie, and then the maitre d' had not let us come in to eat, did the maitre d' make that decision? Or did Tasha's dad? Whose decision was it? When it comes to the wedding guest in Jesus' story, did the king kick the guy out, or did the king simply fulfill a decision that the man had already made. Had he already decided, look, I wasn't going to participate, and so the king just said, have it your way? Does God kick people out of the kingdom of heaven? I don't think so. Or does God simply say yes to the decision that we make ourselves? So C.S. Lewis says this. He says, there are only two kinds of people in the end. Those who say to God, thy will be done, and those to whom God says, thy will be done. What do you think about that? There are only two kinds of people in the end. Those who say to God, thy will be done, and those to whom God says, have it your way. Have it your way. So I want to ask you this. Have you heard and understood God's invitation to new life in God's kingdom? Do you believe that you're a person who has said yes, yes to Jesus and yes to this new life? If so, check your clothes. We all need to do it. Can you point to something that has changed, been remade, or healed within you in response to life with God? Can you point to something? Or what transforming, healing, new life work is God doing in you right now? And how are you cooperating with that work? So I do want to take just a moment and offer a real practical suggestion. If you're interested in how the Holy Spirit transforms us and how Christian transformation happens, which is something we need to understand, there's a great book that I discovered. There's a lot of great books on this, but the one I discovered years ago that has been helpful to me and helpful to many others is a book by James Brian Smith called this one is called The Good and Beautiful God. It's a series of books called The Apprentice Series. And we have groups all throughout our church that are reading and studying this book. And I would just encourage you to grab it. Read it by yourself, but even better if you can join one of the groups as we explore what it means to live this new kingdom life that God calls us to. So I have a little bit of good news. So we're standing there, and Tasha's dad's trying to decide, is he going to put on the tie? Are we going to get to go in and eat? And finally, he agrees, and he puts the tie on, and the maitre d' took us to a lovely table, and we had a wonderful meal together, and it's a cherished memory that still gives us joy to this day. And so Tasha's dad made up his mind. He wanted to participate in that feast. And I guess the question I want to ask you to think about today is this. What decision will you make? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. So you and I have been invited to new life in God's kingdom. We do not have to live out of sync with God and with God's goodness. We can live an abundant life, a life that really is life. Do you want that? That's the question. Do you want that? If so, clothe yourself with the new self created in the likeness of God. And know that as you begin to make that journey and as you begin to take steps in that direction, that Christ will meet you there. Go now, and may the blessings of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.